Hey guys, welcome back to Source of a Nerd. Today we're on Best Thing I Saw All Week.
Mm-hmm.
It's a brand new podcast we're testing out. We did one episode before this. But the basic premise of it is that each of us on the table are going to bring something that we saw this week, the thing we think is the best, hence the title, and we're going to talk about it. You're going to pitch it to us. We've all kind of seen little tidbits of it. We're going to talk about it, why we think it's the best thing we've seen all week. And actually, the fun twist is you guys can actually submit your thing, the thing you think is the best, using the hashtag #BestThingPodcast, sent to us on Twitter, and then we'll sift through all the tweets. We'll pull our favorite, and we'll actually throw it on the show and talk about it, and we'll give you a little shout-out.
What
give
a
you
twist.
A little shout-out.
What a good twist.
Just as a little teaser, Philip, what are you bringing to the table today?
We're going to talk about what took over the box office this weekend, and that's Don't Breathe.
Ooh, I'm very excited about that.
I've not seen it, so no spoilers,
please. Ooh, we'll try our best. Can't promise anything. I'm going to be talking about my favorite show right now, even though you suggested Black Mirror, and I did pick that up, and it's been very good. But one of my all-time favorite shows, Orphan Black. So I'm very excited about that. I just finished season 4, but I won't go into spoilers. But anyways, what are you bringing to the table?
Oh, I'm talking about a game I'm a little...
A game mom.
I'm talking about a game mom.
Uh-huh.
I'm talking about a game that I'm a little late to the party in, and that's the new Doom.
Ooh,
that I'm really enjoying.
Very cool. And actually, you guys suggested something, but I don't want to spoil it.
Yeah,
we're going to get to it soon.
We don't want that person to know.
No, yet. It's going to
so
be a surprise.
Stay tuned.
You got to watch the whole thing if you want to find out if it's...
It'll be the last thing. Yeah. Oh, real quick.
And real quick, here it is. Thank you, Jeffrey, whatever your name is. All right,
Jeffrey.
To kick it off, Whitney.
Okay.
Tell us about Dummy.
Here you go, guys. So check it out.
Check it out.
This is not a thing that I discovered this week, but we didn't do one of these last week, so I started it last week, but I'm counting it anyways. I started streaming for MetalSucks.net. And
little plug.
I do a news show there about metal, if you like metal. And I was like, I think that it'd be really fun to play metal video games Twitch.
Mm-hmm.
It's super fun. And so I kicked it off with Doom because I had not played it. The only context I had about Doom was my dad had it, like the first one on a computer, and it scared the shit out of me when I was a child.
Am I old enough to be your dad?
That's cool.
You're old enough to be my daddy.
Yay! Yeah. Hashtag daddy. That's the hashtag of the show.
I hate that.
Go on. Uh-huh. Make me feel older.
Wait, the other metal game that I was just thinking of, what's that one Jack Black stars in?
Oh, Brutal Legend.
Brutal Legend. That's
that
a very fun metal
great.
Game.
Mm-hmm. That game is so great. Actually, a comic book store I worked at when I was 15, one of my coworkers has a song in Brutal Legend.
Oh, cool.
I can't remember what his band is, but he was super excited. It was awesome.
That's awesome.
Anyway, I started playing Doom, and it's so fucking cool, you guys. It's like, do you know what the concept of Doom is? Like, what the story is?
Throw it to the audience.
Okay. Do you guys know? Because if not,
we'll wait.
Please tell me in the comments what Doom is about. So it's about you wake up, and you're in this facility, and you're chained down, and you're like, who am I? Am I a boy or a girl? Up to you. It's a girl. and all of these demons come out, these skeleton men come out, and they can shoot fireballs at you.
What
and you
a
find
dick
a gun.
Move.
And you can find a gun and you shoot them back, and then you find out that you're in hell or on Mars. I think that it's both.
You know, classic.
Every planet has its own heaven.
I think there's part where you're on a planet that looks like Mars and part where you're in hell. I don't know. I just started playing it. But it's really cool. The monsters are so scary looking and so cool because it's like they're like hell demons. Some of them are monster types and some of them are skeleton boys.
Ooh.
And they all have like fire, like they can shoot flame balls at you, and some of them have guns.
Ooh.
So it's like you're fighting skeletons with guns, and if that's not the coolest thing ever, I don't know what is. Also, what I love about it is you have to, in order to like progress in the game, you have to destroy a thing called gore nests, and it's like this big red throbbing thing that has like faces in it. It's so spooky looking, and you have to like reach in and like grab the heart out,
cool.
And then it emits like a death shriek, and it's like,
oh god!
And then all these demons come, and you gotta get them. It's so fun. The kills are so satisfying. I'm not usually a I'm not usually a first-person shooter fan, but it's so fast-paced and easy to get. I mean, like, the switching between weapons and, like, reloading and everything, it's just very, like, simplified, so it's easy to catch on to. And it's so satisfying, especially the melee kills, because if you need health or ammo, you get more if you do a melee kill. So you go, and it's different almost every time depending on what angle, but it's the most brutal deaths in a video game I've ever seen.
It feels like it's one of the most, the bloodier games that are out.
It's
because
very,
yeah, it's very
bloody. But it's like, there's a skeleton, and there's a skeleton boy, and you go, and you can, like, break his neck, or, like, get his eyes, or like rip his arm off and hit him with it.
That's cool.
It's really cool, and they also play like pretty cool metal while that's all happening.
Cool.
So it's a very metal video game.
That's how it ties back together.
Yeah, that's and it's so much fun to stream too, because it's just like a really crazy run and gun where you gotta like run around and there's not a lot to it in terms of story, but. There's stuff that you can read that's like lore, but also I have not found this yet. Someone on the stream told me that there are on each level there's a secret door, like a lever that you pull, and you can go into a place that makes it look like the old school graphics.
Oh, cool!
No.
That's awesome.
That's the one I used to play, and I remember very vividly. Like once I discovered this little glitch where if you walked into a corner. And the game like didn't understand why you would be so close to a corner, so it would let you see through it. And then you would just like suddenly like see the other side of that wall, but as you like move, you're like, don't see it. And so, and you could get stuck in a corner, so it's like freaking out on you, and I puked.
Oh, no.
You puked?
Yeah, I totally puked, because it was just like made me crazy, like, dude, wait, is the wall there? Is the wall not there? Reality is false. That and Wolfenstein did the same thing.
Wolfenstein did
awesome.
Do it, yeah.
Philip, I feel like you're not cut out for VR. If that,
you know what's weird is that like it's like a very, it's almost like the uncanny valley of like CGI being realistic enough. The more realistic it's gotten, the better I've gotten with it. But like when I was super like I guess when video games got very into being 3D, but weren't really like that good at it yet. Yeah, that was like my nauseous childhood. Bro, just like puking.
My nauseous childhood, a novel by Philip. Yeah.
Autobiography. That's the whole life. But okay, so do you think it would be fun to have a VR component for this, or is this too disgusting?
I would love to play Doom in VR because it's just like the hellscape you're in is so cool, and also you're really OP in it. You're like, you can jump around. The guns you get have really awesome upgrades, and it's just like, I mean, I'm playing on the medium setting because I don't like it to be too hard, but it's like not a hard game to pick up, and so just like running around, slaying demons, that's my dream.
That's my weekend.
We've been talking about the idea, which I think would be so awesome, so like encourage us to do this in the comments, but just doing like scary VR games, and then just like turning off all the lights in the office, and like, you know, just
spooking
murdering the person that's playing.
Literally.
Oh, yeah, that would be really cool.
Literally murder people.
Yeah, like straight up murder.
There's so many horror games coming out this October for VR.
For PlayStation, for Vive, for Oculus. I'm really excited to
Batman.
Check out this game. Oh, wait, Batman VR, of course. Yeah. But to check out this game because my only,
Dog.
My only exposure to Doom was the movie with The Rock and Carl Urban.
I forgot about
forget about that movie because it's so
Was that
bad.
A good movie?
No, so bad.
I gotta watch it.
So,
I love that
so
movie.
Bad.
Was it like fun bad at least?
It's fun bad. Because there's a point when they're like, it's a first-person video game, so it's gonna be a first-person movie. And it's like, is it 3D or VR? It's like hardcore, but only for like maybe 3 minutes of it. And it's at the very end. And like, it's the biggest pitch they had for the movie, and like, so you go and sit down, and you're like, no, it's a normal movie, normal kind of boring movie. LL Cool J's in it.
What?
Yeah, there's a lot of like big names in it, but then all of a sudden at the very end, Carl,
there's a lot of real big names. You got LL Cool J,
The Rock, Carl Urban, but at the very end, all of a sudden it switches to first person, and then it's over in like 10 seconds, so you're like, yeah, it's kind of lame. It's kind of lame.
Weird.
So I want to check out a cool version of Doom.
It's awesome. I highly suggest it if you like shooters. Even if you don't and you just like some of the things like skeleton boys, demons, metal, hell.
I love skeleton
like
boys.
Any of those
can you tell the gender of a skeleton?
Yeah,
too,
I can.
Very easily?
You can tell. I think you can,
by
actually.
By the ribs and hips?
Yeah, the hips.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You know, they're go ahead and then, and you can see if,
and then there's like a dick.
You can see it. Little known fact, you can see the dick in the skeleton.
Look at
it's
that.
It's attached still after
like the
you
ghost
become
in the
a
show.
That's the best thing you saw all week is that you found out you can tell the gender.
Skeleton boners. Mm-hmm. Boners!
We did it. Is that the word of the day? And I forgot.
We made it. That's the word of the day. Whenever we get to boners, we have to scream. Oh, that's really cool. I haven't actually sat down to like play a, what do you call those? Video games? Yeah, in a while.
Dog.
Yeah, dog. Is it dog? Is
do
it dog?
Have a Flash video game?
Oh man, if they did, you know I'd be playing
That'd
it on
so
repeat.
Cool.
I would love it. What's this? Oh, okay,
it's
just making sure. Making sure everybody saw the new shirt I got. That's awesome, though. But that's video games.
Mm-hmm.
That's what
that's
Winnie...
That's my thing. Mm-hmm.
That's the best thing. Let us know in the comments down below or on Twitter using the Best Thing Podcast. If you play Doom, what you think about it.
Mm-hmm.
But moving on a little bit to my thing. Moving over to the table. Thank you.
No,
there
no.
There it goes. I want to talk about Orphan Black. It's a show. It's been on BBC America. It's the American offshoot, which I thought was only for reruns of BBC shows,
mm-hmm.
wanted to make their own original content, and this is their like flagship show. Stars Tatiana Maslany, who is kind of just a Canadian actress that wasn't doing too many big roles, but they let her star in this series, and it kind of sucks because when they marketed the show, they said, it's about clones, and like,
mm-hmm.
but if you watched the show and you didn't know that, it would be a complete mind fuck, because it's a very cool sci-fi show, because I think
you
like
that?
It.
I know, right? Anyone that hasn't watched the show here.
Too late, there's
I
a picture. There's a picture of Orphan Black with all the clones in it. Yeah. Like, no, there's like nine sisters, it's like, no, it's clones. But Tatiana Maslany plays every clone, and the way they shoot it is like they don't even have like locked off shots. They don't have the clones not interacting. They're insane because they use body doubles in every single scene, and then she'll go back and change her costume
mm-hmm.
and do her makeup different, and then go do the other character.
Interesting.
So it must take an unbelievably long amount of, like of time. And then
I wonder if she has an acting partner that she does the scenes with.
Sometimes
probably
though, there could be
double.
Four like clones in a scene. That's why it gets confusing. Like there was one time where they shook hands, and I was looking,
what?
How the hell did they do that? Like it was the same hands.
How do they do that?
And it
maybe
wasn't
like
a
face
cut.
Replacement,
I don't know. It was awesome
face
though.
Swap.
But it's
yeah. They use a Snapchat filter.
Yeah, that's what the whole invented it, and the Snapchat was like, "Can we use our shit now?" Yeah. But the show is, if you're a fan of sci-fi and slightly futuristic genetic experimentation type stuff,
mm-hmm.
that's what the show deals with, and also just unpacking the mystery of like this woman, basically. She finds out in the craziest circumstance ever that there's another woman that looks like her.
Mm-hmm.
And she's like this drifter, like drug addict. And you're like, she's like kind of thinking she's going crazy, maybe not. And she tries to assume the life of this person.
Whoa,
you'll find out why.
That's
she's
so scary.
She's the main character, though. And you'll find out why. And you kind of root for her, you kind of don't. But then the more she realizes, like, she has like numbers in her phone. And when she like starts talking to people, she starts to realize they have the same voice as her. And she's like, that would have been so cool if you didn't know that it was clones. And because it would be like, oh man, she's going crazy. And then she goes and meets like more and more clones. And you meet Cassima, she's got dreadlocks. And you meet Allison, she's a soccer mom. You meet Helena, who is like this crazy, Eastern European woman. Like she always says sistras, and they like call each other the sistras. And she's like, babies, you never hurt babies. And she's insane, and she's crazy, and she's the way that Tatiana did, like creates her characters, like it's so impressive. If you ever want to go into acting, because or if you do act and you're like, I'm not feeling motivated, you can go watch her, because she's built out completely all of these characters, and when they're in scenes together, you forget it's the same actress playing it. You're like, no, that's a different actress, that's a different actress. It's really cool.
That's awesome.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sold.
Mm-hmm.
So it's cool, despite the fact that we now know it's clones.
Nah, that will not be the big. That is not the big. That's the secret of episode one.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So I saw episode one, so I think we should institute a rule. Anytime we're gonna recommend a TV show to each other, we gotta tell each other how many episodes to give it.
Because
I saw the pilot.
That's a great idea.
And I got a little. I was like, oh, this is kind of cool, but like, I have to watch so much TV and movies right now. Like, just to add one more. I wasn't 100% sold by the pilot.
That's strange.
So,
for me, I didn't know much, so it grabbed me immediately.
I did know about the clones going in.
Mm-hmm. I would say give it to episode 3. Yeah, because that's when they throw in a bunch of like clones, and also they start building out the mystery, and it starts your brain starts exploding.
Okay. I feel like three episodes in general is a good rule of thumb.
Yeah, sometimes. I mean, if you're trying to get into Buffy and it's like you're on
Buffy
season one,
is like a life goal that you want to finish that show.
Yeah, but think of like no, but like it's like give it season one is what you have to say, or whatever, and then but like season two on, you're pretty much like okay, I get it.
I can't do that because I was burned by Supernatural because people were like, oh, just wait till season three, and those are 22 episode seasons,
man.
An hour long, and then you're like, wow, these are the most boring people on the planet, and they're like hunting demons, and I'm like, I don't care.
Buffy has Joss Whedon behind it.
He does.
Speaking
true.
Of, Joss Whedon was involved in Dollhouse, yes?
Dollhouse.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, separate that from Orphan Black.
I don't know Dolphin. Dolphin House.
I don't know a Dolphin House.
What is Dolphin?
What's the difference between a Dolphin and Orphan Black? maybe somebody in the comments can do it for us.
Yeah, there's a lot of... Well, it lasted longer than how many insert seasons of Dollhouse, because apparently Fox didn't like it very much, but I've heard good things. But this show, it deals with family. It deals with mystery. It's I'd say give it three episodes for the first season, and they're only 8-episode seasons.
Ooh, nice.
Yeah, so they're very like contained. I think one season goes to 10.
Dude, BBC, that's about it. I love it. It's like, except for Peep Show, I wish there were a million more episodes of that show.
I've wanted to watch that. It's on Hulu, and I've never watched it.
Sam, it's good. Incredible.
Getting a thumbs up from Joel.
You gotta watch Peep Show. It's so
Chris.
Good. Everybody watch Peep Show.
It's a point of view show, right?
Yeah, yeah. It's so good. It's just great. But it's like 6 or 8 episodes or something.
And that's it?
Yeah. No, and there's like 3 seasons, but it's never enough. Mm-hmm.
Okay. It's never enough.
Never enough.
BBC knows how to structure their shows that way.
No, I'm going to kind of like, it's an unpopular opinion, but I don't love the way they do the Sherlock seasons. If there's like a one that you don't love, you're kind of like, well, a third of this season I didn't love. You know, just like they're so weighted every single one.
But at least
of them.
If you don't like the season, it's over soon.
Mm-hmm. No, like, but like I like every season of it. It's more like, man, you guys made a whole movie for the episode 2 that like we didn't need that one. Like
I'm gonna be honest, I've never watched Sherlock, and I've tried really hard because everyone loves it. Everybody loves Sherlock, but it's just like. I didn't know I was sitting down to watch a movie.
Movies.
Yeah.
That's the one with
Bonadalcor Kimberbridge.
Brimberbrick. Brendan Fraser. That's it. Yeah, with Brendan Fraser.
LL Cool J. Brendan Fraser.
The Rock. Yeah. I'd watch that Sherlock.
Sherlock. I would love to watch that Sherlock.
Yeah, it's The Rock.
Make a fan fiction.
The Rock is Sherlock.
No, Brendan Fraser.
You want... fine. He needs work. Yeah, let's go.
He'd be Watson.
Who?
Right.
Brendan Fraser.
Wouldn't mind seeing The Rock as...
Sherlock.
Wait, who's... Oh, actually, we need it for the name. Never mind. He's going to be Sherlock. There you go.
Sherlock. Yeah,
yeah, yeah. I was like, never
mind. I wouldn't mind seeing The Rock in literally any role. I love him.
No, I love him, too. I think everyone loves him.
Yeah, we all saw that. Well, I showed Whitney that picture of The Rock earlier, now that he's going to be in the sequel to Jumanji.
God.
He's basically The Rock meets Indiana Jones.
Yeah,
okay, then I did see that photo. It's a good one.
So up my alley.
If you know what you mean.
Mm-hmm. So are you guys down for clones? Are you guys down for... mystery, you guys down for sci-fi fun.
Yes, those are all things that I like.
Do you think you'll ever check out the show?
Yeah, definitely.
On the list of all shows.
You watched Black Mirror last night, so was that the one where you were like, you watch this and I'll watch that? Mm-hmm. So yeah, I have
That's
to, because you started watching Black Mirror.
Mm-hmm. And you have to go through the titles that have the word black in them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
all of them. That's awesome.
Blackula.
I only drink sun-kissed soda on days that end in Y.
You mean generic brand soda?
I mean orange drink that I flavored myself.
I'll watch it. I wanted to, and I was like, oh, I like this, but currently I like it like fifth of the things I gotta watch.
Mm-hmm.
But like, I'll give it 2 more episodes because that's what you told me to do.
Yeah,
2 more episodes.
Pretty simple. Okay. They're hour long. You have little snacks every day. It's like a snack. Orphan Black's like
an
snack.
Hour long
like
a meal. Snack.
An hour long.
That's a meal.
No, it's not in my house. No, a box of cheese takes an hour to eat. That's a snack. All right.
I'm supposed to eat an entire box of cheese in one sitting.
Hey, excuse me. A jar of Nutella is a snack. All right. It's a snack. All right.
Oh, you,
Philip.
So I saw Don't Breathe last night, actually, and if you know me from my previous works, I am very like. like I see a lot of like references and stuff when I'm watching something, and I get excited and giddy by them. So like immediately after, I started taking notes, like just like as I was walking out of theater, of like the things that I thought were so exciting. So Don't Breathe is, it's a pretty small horror movie. If you haven't seen it, you might be watching the trailer right now on screen.
Mm-hmm. Or the VR experience, which I am.
Yeah,
in.
Which Whitney Moore is
really
in,
you
which
are
is so cool. I'm it's in a basically trailer for the trailer,
really,
remade, but it's remade the 360 style, so you can kind of like click around.
So you play the girl in it?
Yes,
yeah,
because
yeah. we have similar hair.
You, no, you guys honestly do look a lot like. She's I think the same girl from Evil Dead. Mm. But
that
so
makes sense.
That's the director is Fede Alvarez.
Uh-huh.
And he's basically Sam Raimi's like Padawan or something, that he's like gonna be this up and coming horror director, and he's a great director, it turns out.
Did you like Evil Dead the remake?
I did. I didn't remember all the details of it until I like went back to start looking at it again, and I was like, oh man, this was a severely creepy movie.
I did not like the new Evil Dead.
See, I haven't seen it. I've only heard negative things. So you're the only
first
person.
Well, it's tough because I'll say that I'm also like very, I don't want to say lenient on horror movies, but like there's certain boxes it has to check, and if it does, I enjoy that horror movie.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Some of those boxes, I'll be honest, I'm very critical of like screenplays. That's not one of them on horror movies.
Yeah, no, like, not at all.
I can find plot holes. I mean, there are plot holes in Don't Breathe. If I were that type of person, I'd call that out. But I like being a fan of the things I'm a fan of, and so I try not to like tear them down.
Yeah.
But like, it's more the things that I fell in love with, like just these visuals. So the guy is kind of being, if you know David Fincher's visual style. It gets mimicked by everyone now, but it's this idea that the camera is almost like God's eye, and it can float through any scene and kind of move throughout the space. So when you have a movie that's like limited to just this one location, it's this one house where all the lights are off, the fact that the camera is able to kind of swing around and add like it's almost like you're in a new scene because the camera swung into a corner that we previously hadn't seen. It's like, oh, there's a person hiding there. Just a very, it's another way to tell a story without having to be like, and now they cut to the foot chase, and now they cut to this. Like, you, the camera can consistently build up heightening or take it away. And that also has a lot to do with the editing. If you saw It Follows, another horror movie that like knows how to rock a camera
it's so awesome.
Much tension. But this movie, I would say, is about as good as those 80s horror movies that It Follows is mimicking in terms of building tension specifically.
Yes. Mm.
And it is one of the most tense movies you ever see. If you like the kind of movies that, you know, they say that cliche statement, you're on the edge of your seat. But it is that kind of thing where it's like every moment is drawing one more breath out of you, and you forget to breathe, and you have that one big moment where you're like,
because I was able to see it over the weekend, and you think just for a second you're gonna get a break, and the director won't let you relax the entire movie.
Yeah, yeah, it just is nonstop, relentless. It's like Terminator, which I feel like James Cameron and Ridley Scott, that's another influence. There's a shot actually that looks straight out of the movie Alien, and which is an 80s movie that you guys should check out if you want to see. Something that's really interesting, where the movie, if you look at the movie Alien, you look at Aliens, they're two different genres. One is like just a horror monster movie, and then the other one is Aliens, where they come and they attack as kind of a swarm. But when you're watching this movie, they turn an old blind man into a monster in a house. And they do it with the visual tricks and with there's very little dialogue, so it's very much in the sound design, which probably, like, it's not going to win any awards except it could for sound. The sound in this movie,
do
the
horror movies win awards ever?
Some, I mean,
very rarely.
Yeah, it would be cool if this did, because it was very good. Also, the cinematography was amazing in this, which you brought up, that, like, basically in a scene, you would be looking at a very simple thing or just a simple character, and all it would need to do is just pivot a little bit to reveal something behind it, and it automatically tension rises, and
I
you're
love
like,
it.
What's gonna happen?
I feel like that's such a fresh take on the home invasion thriller, which
definitely.
I love, but I mean, you
home
gotta
alone,
just.
Home Alone.
Home Alone
2, Home Alone 3,
those are all of them.
Home Alone in a Panic Room. Panic Room, honestly, though, so that's Fincher, is very similar. If you enjoyed Panic Room, you will like this movie. I'll say this movie's way more tense than Panic Room. Panic Room, by the way, stars a young androgynous Kristen Stewart.
Really?
Oh yeah, she's the daughter. Yeah.
Or the son?
No, yeah.
People aren't sure. But it's very similar to that movie, but way higher stakes and a much stronger threat. This director, he is, so whether or not you liked Evil Dead, he is this up-and-coming guy, and he actually was a little known for a short film he made in 2009. Mm-hmm. It's called Panic Attack. And it's real short. It's 5 minutes. You can find it on YouTube if you want to look it up. It's technically in Spanish, but it doesn't matter. It's
you'll still get it.
You'll totally mm-hmm. get it. And I think that it's a good way. Just go watch that, and you'll understand. Oh, there's ways to build tension without any dialogue, without even any plot. Pay a lot of attention to the way he shows an image and then cuts away from it. And there's one specific shot I'd point out to you if you're a student of filmmaking. So robots are attacking a city. That's it. That's all you know. And you're seeing it happen. These giant, very giant robots are attacking the city. And chaos starts to ensue. And there's this one moment where it cuts to kind of people trying to run as being shot at. And you see the classic, it's a reference to Battleship Potemkin, the baby stroller going down steps, a staircase of steps. And if you don't know that shot, also look it up on Battleship Potemkin. It's one of the classic Russian cinema pieces that introduced the idea of editing montages. It's the first time people understood, holy crap, it can get so tense when you cut away from something when you don't want to. So the baby stroller is going down the staircase, and then it just cuts away, and you never see it again.
That's shitty.
I could listen to you talk about movies for forever.
I'd love to. I love movies so much.
Can you create an audiobook?
About it.
Yeah. I'll get somebody else to narrate it. They are such pieces of art that even when it's a bad movie, that to get into movie making, you work with the best people in the world, at some stage. So even if your movie freaking sucks and has the worst writers, I bet that you got a real legit cinematographer. Mm-hmm. There's always these amazing pieces of art in any major film that you're seeing. And this movie, so go see Don't Breathe. Go crap yourself repeatedly. But on top of that, acknowledge how you are having physiological responses. Your body, you're not breathing, right? Mm-hmm. You're also maybe he'll hear me while you're sitting there. Acknowledge the fact that a guy is making you do that with just his visuals and a couple of sounds, but no words really.
Yeah. I was left feeling the exact same way. Yeah. I was like, I wonder what it would feel like to show this to your friends or family. If Fede or I thought he read Fetty, so I was like, Fetty Wap. Yeah. And then I just imagine him okay, mom and dad, come around. I'm going to show you my movie that I made. Here you go. Go ahead and watch it. And then they leave kind of needing to have a heart attack or puke or something. Yeah.
Okay. And we haven't even acknowledged, and we're not going to spoil it. Sam and I made a promise to not spoil
this weekend.
But I will say there is one moment.
I thought you were saying, but here it is.
Here's the huge spoiler. Yeah. There is one moment. It's one of these movies you do have to watch it this weekend if you can, because people are going to spoil this intense scene.
I'm surprised it hasn't been spoiled yet.
Mm. Yeah, it's not really out there. And it's the kind of scene, so I was listening to the director speak about that scene in specifically, and he was calling out every director has a scene that he has to fight for usually. Hmm. And in horror movies, it's usually a scene where the studio's like, no, you cannot do that. Please, anything else. And he was like, when they came back at me and said, oh, you can't do that, he's like, oh, now you just convinced me that I have to. Because every good horror movie has a one scene where you're just like, I can't believe they got away with that and put that in a movie.
I love the idea. Love the idea that studios, there's always one scene. And I like the idea that the studios don't want it to be in there because they're too scared.
Please take it out. And you're like, it's a movie.
Yeah.
No.
I would love it to be that they're actually too afraid of it.
Too
like the exec at Fox is like, what the hell, man? I can't sleep.
Yeah. Is there any other movie that you guys have watched that's like a whole? Let's try to stay within horror, where you just kind of like get up, or you like physically stand, or you need to like turn away or cover your eye, like really.
It Follows for sure. It Follows for sure. Like really? Just the gut reaction with. Again, not spoiling too much of that movie, but the scene when they're on the beach and the person's walking towards them.
Entire thing. I love how brightly lit that all is.
Yeah, because it's just like, you know what's happening, they don't know what's happening, and it's not like the director's not trying to be like a middle finger. I was about to flip off the camera, but it's like it's not trying to be like a middle finger to you thinking you're stupid. It's like that you're smart and that you have to watch this horrible whatever's gonna happen.
It's
this horrible
so
scene.
So scary!
Out.
I forgot all about that scene.
And then
oh
it goes
God.
To the awesome car scene where it's the no cuts of the car backing up and then getting in that car wreck. It's very cool.
Oh, I love that movie.
So it's a scene
good.
That like I was like on the couch and I was like throwing pillows at the TV. I was like, come on, like man, come on, please.
Do you have a...
That's definitely... I couldn't think of anything, but I agree with Sam. The only other thing is there was, for a very different reason, the movie Baskin, which I didn't love.
I can't watch... I can't watch that movie.
I didn't love it. It drags a little bit, to be honest. But
it's
I mean,
film.
Again, with like, you know, Whitney, Hail Satan, whatever. It's great. And, but there were a lot of scenes that were like too disgusting for me to watch. And it wasn't like too scary. It was. I just got super.
I'll tell you.
Out.
Okay, so gore is like one place where I can sometimes be in the mood for it, and I'm like, yeah, I want to see the goriest gore that's out there. But it's the thing that like I'm talking about here. I think it's like so impressive when it's without any gore. Mm-hmm. So like how Sam's talking about like the approach.
Totally.
For me, one movie that I remember that definitely did it. No matter what you think of these movies now, the first. Video camera, every Halloween they come out.
Paranormal
Activity. Mm-hmm. The first Paranormal Activity movie, I saw it. It's the ideal scenario where you see it in a packed theater,
yes,
in a bad neighborhood.
Only movie I ever snuck into.
Oh,
but
really?
Yeah, I wanted to see it so bad.
So it was like a neighborhood like where just like movie night is like the thing. So it was just totally packed. And I remember being like giddy about how successful this film was being when there's a shot, it's mid-movie, not too much has happened yet, but all that happens is it's like the time lapse is happening and it's going from day to night and literally like nothing is happening on screen except the sun is going down. Mm. And so you know another night is coming. I think maybe it says like night 3 on screen or something, but I remember everyone in the
like
theater-
Like in Majora's Mask.
Link and Legends of Zelda. Yeah, Legends of Zelda. Yeah. down the street.
I don't know your boyfriend. So the lights are going down or whatever. It's like night 3. I remember it was like dead silent in the theater, and you like heard someone make a sound that everyone was feeling, and they just went no, and it was just from like the night 3. Like nothing happened. Like, man, this movie is killing it right now. If just the concept of night makes us literally squirm in our seats.
That is rad.
Before we get like to the fan submitted one, I do want to say I love that all these horror movies are coming out, like Lights Out and It Follows and Don't Breathe. And they're made on such an easy budget. They're like $5 million, $2 million.
Get made so often.
Right? But like, it also makes me feel good because I'm like, make more movies like these.
Yes.
Make more movies of this caliber.
Original movies.
Which is hard. It's a hard thing to do. It's not easy, but thank God there's been like a nice.
And The Witch.
Like, The Witch. Yeah.
So this
so
year
ones,
has had
so
with
many
not
horror
a lot of gore
horror.
In The Witch or It Follows at all, really.
You don't need it.
But 2016 has been a kind of like renaissance for horror, I would say, definitely, and like original stories being told. This movie, again, Don't Breathe, not to like force it back there, but when you're like, well, it's a home invasion movie, wait till Act 3. And then you're kind of like, holy crap, this movie doesn't stop. It doesn't end the way I thought it would. And also Act 2 has like a lot of insane stuff, but you definitely are like, people can still tell original stories. And I think that's awesome when a horror movie is original.
You guys, we have to do a horror show.
Yeah.
We have to do something.
So excited,
we have to watch the worst of the worst. The book. You make me piss myself. All right.
As we go into Twitter.
I asked you guys using the hashtag #BestThingPodcast to send me the things that you thought were the best thing you saw this week. And I'm picking Matt Friesen at Matt Friesen. He wrote it the both ways. Matt Friesen and the Matt Friesen. I like that. That's awesome.
Can you
awesome.
Say it one more time? What
Matt
is it?
Matt Friesen.
There you go.
Friesen. Finished binging Stranger Things the last 2 days. Really enjoyed it. An instant classic for sure. Best Thing podcast. And that's what got me the idea of the best Stranger Things season 2 trailer that dropped this week.
Yes.
And roll right there
solid.
On the screen. The Stranger Things season 2 little trailer. We were teased some titles for episodes in the next season. And we're getting a another episode on top of all of this.
Nine episodes. I think all of us were like, oh, I'm going to binge this so hard. And then it started and you were like, it's eight episodes. You're like, oh no.
Yeah. At first it felt good because I was like, ah, yeah, I don't need to watch like 13 episodes.
Yeah. And I was like, I want it to last.
Yeah.
Oh, it's so good.
Yeah. So I'm very excited. I wanted to ask you guys at the table, what do you want to see in the season two of Stranger Things?
So I'm going to, well, I'm going to read off a quick list just so we all... Yeah, I have a list of the episode titles because I want us to, like, kind of, like, within that, see what we're hoping these could mean and what we want to see through them. So let's see. They are...
No, one's called The Boy Who Came Back to Life.
Right.
The don't... Yep.
Which I'm hoping has is going to obviously pick up about that those... Not to spoil the series, but at the end of the show... where the slug comes out of someone's throat. It's like, oh, let's...
not spoil it.
let's pick that back up. So Mad Max, The Boy Who Came Back to Life, The Pumpkin Patch, The Palace, The Storm, The Pollywog, The Secret Cabin, The Brain, and finally, The Lost Brother.
So
in those, what are we hoping shows up in those?
I hope there's a lost brother.
Ooh, that's
I don't
nice.
Think they'll be.
I'm feeling like the palace is like we had the company that was running these experiments. I feel like this is the headquarters of where that is, and we get to learn more about MK Ultra and like what other experiments. I think the lost brother is referring to other children that were born with maybe not similar powers to Eleven, but also something otherworldly.
Right. Well, I think, yeah, perfect match if Eleven had a brother, like in the sibling stories.
So cool.
And then, like, kicks off for
12.
Season 3.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Right. Yeah. I'm so into that idea.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Eleven's brother. Yeah, for sure. I'm on with you on the palace. I think it's going to be like, so, like, usually it's like a structure that needs to be invaded or something, but I'm also going to connect it and remind people that they last season ended talking about the princess. Remember they like made a little reference what happens to the princess, and it's like, oh, the princess in the palace. I wonder if the princess is Eleven.
Oh yeah.
Then the palace could be like the home where she belongs, you know, back in her space.
But they can also be trapped in the palace, like they need to be broken out of. Mad Max could be a fun way of having an episode that takes place completely in the Upside Down, because it's like it's supposed to be hell world. It's supposed to be like a goddamn nightmare, and it could be other people trapped there with new monsters, maybe.
If you've seen Mad Max, you definitely like you're wowed by the mutations of people. So like seeing monsters would be great. But I'll even tag that with the idea of when you have a Mad Max apocalyptic world, you need a Mad Max figure. So maybe our sheriff. Hooper,
I was just wondering about him because he. Hooper? I hope his story. What's his name? I hope his story continues.
Yeah.
He was one of my favorite parts of that whole show.
I believe he's returning. And so
they said that, I think they said almost everybody is returning.
They didn't just say anything
they
about
hinted.
Eleven.
They didn't say anything about her. There is a new girl being added to the cast. Real quick, I'll say, I hope Hopper goes into the Upside Down and has to like take over the world or whatever. But about that new girl, don't read the description about that new girl. Mm-hmm. It's going to make you, like, not excited.
It's Zooey Deschanel.
She's a little different from girls of her time. And, like, it reminds me of the Simpsons episode where they add a cool new character to a sitcom to try to, like, make it cooler.
What was the dog? Poochie? Yeah, Poochie. Yeah, it's Poochie.
Yeah. And so the description is pretty cringeworthy. It's like, she likes what boys like. And she doesn't ride bikes. She rides a skateboard. And, like, that's what the description of this girl is.
Oh, crazy.
Like, it's the Upside Down world in real life. Like, okay, fine. She has a skateboard.
Think about this.
She plays video games.
Who else was Who else was a badass in Mad Max that wasn't Max?
The guitar guy?
No, you're thinking of Furiosa.
Furiosa, who also looks like Furiosa.
Like Philip Molina.
Pretty close.
Cut to my Halloween picture where I did go as Furiosa this year.
That's cool. But I'm thinking 11. I think Eleven's a little aged and she's being a badass.
I think so. Yeah. But I guess we're skipping that point. Eleven's probably coming back.
Yeah.
She's got to come back.
You can't
have Stranger Things without Eleven. She's important.
She's one of the more Stranger Things.
Important. Yeah. Probably the strangest.
Yeah.
She's the strangest thing.
I like the idea of the Pollywog. I just think that's cute. I think that's in the so when you're becoming a frog, you know when you guys became a frog, remember
yeah.
that?
Yeah.
And you like tadpoles or whatever. I think that I think one
polywog
of the stages
is when
is a
you
polywog.
Like it's like teenage frog. Mm-hmm. It's like before you get to be a frog, you got
you, like,
you
get
little
get weird,
legs.
You ride skateboards.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
So I think that could be related to maybe what the slug thing is.
Oh.
Yeah.
It kind of seems like that. Maybe they call it that.
Idea.
Sam.
Idea. Okay, so we're pulling from every like awesome 80s movie ever. Mm-hmm. We haven't pulled from E.T. yet. What's the best?
Sam Basher.
Wait. In the way that I mean, I'm about to get to the point.
Okay, I'm about to
get to the point, as in we don't have a monster yet. A monster was born at the end of season one that slipped out of that little boy's mouth, and it's got to transform into whatever it's going to turn into. The Poliwag could be like this thing that someone's
that
like raising, like a monster or something.
And this connects it to E.T. for you, not the million references.
No, I didn't catch a single other E.T. reference.
I love that.
I didn't see any bikes flying in Stranger Things,
yeah,
did you?
Yeah, they almost did.
The car did.
You know what, though? I'm going to say, here's a possible E.T. reference. The Pumpkin Patch episode... Halloween is probably going to take place then. And 1984 Halloween sounds like a real like raw childhood moment.
Mm-hmm.
E.T. has a Halloween moment in it too. So
I thought you were say E.T. Halloween special.
No, the E.T. Halloween special was great, if you remember. No, I'm trying to salvage your E.T. connection.
Oh, I got a great E.T. connection.
No, I think there will be absolutely way more E.T. stuff, including just kids... in Halloween costumes riding bikes. Mm-hmm. I think we'll see that.
Yeah.
I love
excited.
That image.
Yeah. Aww. All right. What anything you're most excited for? Any one thing you want to yell out there? What's the one thing you're most
about
excited
about? Stranger Things?
Yes. Ouch.
I don't know. I think we got it. I think we covered it. But this is unrelated. I just wanted to know because I showed Philip this morning. Have you seen the Friday the 13th vinyl that has blood in it?
No.
It's so cool. Guys. Well, this is go just turning into a horror movie podcast, but they released the Friday the 13th record, and it is clear and has blood in it.
Yum.
Like, I'm assuming it's real.
Yeah, it's the director's blood. Yeah.
Yeah.
I can assume that. But
it's just like the...
Yeah.
Right.
Wait for like 13 hours on the
desert.
The whole song. Yeah. And then the blood kind of messes it up when it plays.
Yeah.
Yay. Well, guys, that was a lot of fun. Thank you so much for joining us on the Best Thing I Saw All Week podcast here on SourceFed Nerd. Philip, where can they find you?
You can find me on Twitter at Fimo or anywhere else, probably at Fimo Knows.
Very cool. Whitney.
Tweetney Moore, Instagram, Snap, Whitney S. Moore. Also, metalsucks.net.
Very cool. You can
Sam.
Follow me.
Where can we find you?
I like your hands. They're soft.
Bring it in.
It's very warm. I'm very damp. You can follow me on Twitter and Instagram at Sam Basher. But biggest thing, you can send us your thoughts on the show and also suggestions using the hashtag #BestThingPodcast. And also you can listen to this on youtube.com/sourcefednerd/damp.
Sam started it.
Sam started it.
3, 2, 1, damp.
Damp. Like, subscribe, do all the fun stuff. Bye.
Ready for some Star Wars news?
It's not a lightsaber.